not only doing archaeology outside the Mediterranean, but it's actually doing it, as you can see, in the intertidal zone. And specifically, Daniel's going to be talking about the methods and the issues he's encountering doing this work, but he's also going to focus somewhat on the ship construction of the vessels he's looking at, because the particular module we're doing right now is methods of ship construction within the themes class. So we did sewn and laced vessels, now we're going to be doing vessels from Northern Europe. So what we're going to hear today is, well, this photo was taken just less than a week ago, so a lot of very recent work in the North Sea and the Wadden Sea. So Daniel, the floor is yours, as they say.
Thanks for inviting me, Matthew.
You're welcome.
And it's a great pleasure to be here. And it is also my great pleasure to introduce you to a field that is probably quite new to you, for at least from a Mediterranean perspective, and also in terms of ship construction, because ship construction is quite different in the northern part of Europe. And although the ships that I will present to you, this is only just a fraction, it's not a complete overview of the kind of shipwrecks that you would encounter in the North Sea. I've been carrying out this work on behalf of the State Archaeology Department of Schleswig-Holstein, and I will focus specifically on the North Frisian Wadden Sea, the North Sea coast, basically, of Schleswig-Holstein. And here you can see an overview of shipwrecks that have been registered so far by the State Archaeology Department of Schleswig-Holstein. You can see already I indicated on the map the date of discovery, but also they get regularly silted up again, and so, and at one point some of the wrecks re-emerge as a consequence of coastal erosion and tidal currents, and some even get destroyed due to the forces of nature. And this is a very peculiar environment. Here you see map as a contrast showing all the historically recorded strandings, and of course that is much more. So we basically have only the tip of the iceberg of the wrecks that have been discovered so far. And can you imagine why there's all the wrecks are clustered around the outer Frisian islands? Do you have any idea?
So the black spots are the recorded strandings of the sites?
Yes, okay. Exactly. Okay. Yeah. And on the right side, that's a physical wreck remains that have been discovered. And anyone wants to take this question?
Does it come down to just the tidal range? Like you can't get the boats closer?
No. It's because, are there any sailors here?
More or less.
This can be explained by the specific type of landscape. You see this very low-lying coastline.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have any sheltered anchorages. Okay. And all the lands would be really exposed to storms. You had no safe anchorages, no bays or stuff like that. And also much of the area that you see on that photo, that would be land at low tide. You can basically walk across the entire area at low tide. And this is indicated by the gray, gray areas on the map on the right. All of that would be land at low tide, and flooded again a few hours later. So you have a highly dynamic environment, and also quite treacherous in many ways, because the slope or the depth was very gradual, and the sand banks would be always changing their position. They would be always moving, and including the navigable channels. And especially in an age where you were depth sounding with basically manually depth sounding, and this must have presented a very great challenge. And but the greatest danger was, of course, to the lee shore, because in onshore winds, this was basically a trap when you could not effectively beat against the wind, and you had no good anchoring ground. Mm-hmm. You were just washed ashore. And that's why so many wrecks are clustered around the outer sands.
And basically piled up.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And
Goodwin Sands in the Upper Britain.
Yeah.
It's a very similar situation. They're trying to put a canal through there, and they're saying there's thousands of shipwrecks recorded.
Right. So the many trade routes, they actually kept a great distance to the coast in order to avoid the lee shore, but which could, of course, not always be avoided in the age of sail. The coast was also subject to great storms, floodings. Here you see the island, one of the islands, and with basically people rowing around in boats and in the streets, and some of the dikes have broken. And this is the second great men drowning, literally. With thousands of people dying. It's quite similar to the images of the tsunami, I guess.
The biblical flood, yeah.
Yeah, and this really changed also the topography of the islands. And here you see also a contemporary cut of, that was the impression of the areas that got flooded in the winter flood of 1717. And the area marked in green shows the areas that were flooded according to the one who made this wood card. And there's an anachronism in this map, because you see this island here, inverted U-shape.
Yeah.
This was actually this island. It was torn apart.
Huh.
It was once connected. And within just maybe 2 or 3 days, this basically stream emerged.
Mm-hmm.
And this just gives you the an idea, an impression of the forces of nature. And basically this island was torn apart with thousands of souls lost in several mm-hmm. villages. And this really... And you had a gradual loss of land throughout the centuries, since the Middle Ages. And quite characteristically, and finally, we come to shipwrecks. And here you find on the same map, magnified, zoomed-in portion of the map, with a ship basically washed ashore through at where the dike has broken, right? Mm-hmm. And incidentally, these kind of washed ashore wrecks are the earliest wrecks in Schleswig-Holstein that have been investigated archaeologically. This is the earliest wreck find that was archaeologically investigated, the Hedwig & Koch wreck of 1619. I guess you're dealing with much older stuff over here, but we are more in the post-medieval and early modern period with our wrecks. And this was discovered as early as 1969. And then another wreck of Ulvesbill, also found on land, right at the crevice of a dike. Although this is just a hypothesis, although a very likely one, those ships might have been intentionally maneuvered into the crevice of the dike to basically pluck the dike, and also to serve as a firm foundation to refill and rebuild the dike, right? And otherwise it might just wash away, but so you had a firm foundation to put up.
Has anyone tested that idea?
No, that would be quite interesting for experimental archaeology.
Well, not even experimentally, just to do other excavations within the dike to see if you find other examples.
But I think from the...
For landfill and urban ports.
Yeah, in New York.
Right, yeah. And I think from the stratigraphy of the dike, it emerged as that this was certainly a crevice in the dike. And, but now we are coming to wrecks that I have investigated myself, and starting with one at the Japsand, one of the outer Frisian barrier islands that is not inhabited because it's basically inundated very often. You see it on the left-hand side, basically two wreck sections, and just west of the tidal island of Hoge. Hallig is the German word for tidal island, because also that island gets flooded, although not as regularly as the Japsand. And the landscape around this island is also very interesting because you find settlement remains in the Wadden area because the coastline was always changing. And this is just the change of the coastline in the early modern period. But in medieval times, the Japsand on the left hand side was actually formed part of the entire island. So it was initially much larger than it is now. And so you find settlement remains like masonry from wells right in the middle of the sea. It's really bizarre. And
they're still in situ?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
So it's
in situ.
Like
entire wells, basically. And you can see them when you cross the tidal mudflats at low tide.
Yeah.
You can actually walk there to the Japsand at low tide,
yeah.
But you have to be fast because that would be inundated a few hours later. And sometimes it looks like this when the entire island is flooded and only the dwelling mounds, the so-called wafts, are still popping out from the sea. And so you can really imagine the force of nature in the Wadden Sea area. And some of the dwelling mounds, they were lost in previous storms, right? So, and this probably a future storm will lead to a loss of life in the future, I would imagine. So it's actually quite dangerous to live there in the long term, not in the short term, obviously, but... But getting back to the wrecks, basically we had to plan that very carefully because all the area which you can see here would be flooded again. Here's a tidal creek that we had to wade through, and basically we were walking on the seabed, as you can see by the rippled surface, and In the background, in the mist, you can see the dwelling mound. I'm not sure if they are not recognized. You can see a dwelling mound here.
Oh, I see it. Yeah.
And that gives you an idea of the distance covered. And here's the first wreck fragment. It doesn't look very spectacular, to be honest. But of course, it's an information value that is interesting. And so basically, we had to adopt a strategy of very fast recording because we had only a time window of about 2 hours or even less. So we were taking many photos just to create a structure for motion model. And this is the author view of that model. And some manual recording, as you can see here, because some details could not be reconstructed from the photos. And here you can see me doing some recording. And here we had already the we have taken already the samples, as you can see from the cross section. And question to the audience. Is there anything particular that you can spot here in the construction of the vessel?
Can Monrosella.
Clinker and looks like it's both clinker and caramel.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
And that's indeed. Or lap strike. Clinker it's called when it's riveted, or lap strike is an umbrella term, but we don't have to be, we don't have to split hairs. And so it's basically, yeah, this was my sketch basically of some recordings, some samples.
That's archaeology.
And, and then we basically ripped it apart because there was no point in situ preservation. It would wash away anyway, right? And so we just wanted the information.
So what then, what is the plan for something like this? Like, are you taking it to a museum for conservation?
No. We just took some samples,
yeah,
and we just ripped it apart just to get an idea how the framing was looked behind that planking.
Yeah.
And so, and then we basically left it there because there's no point in preserving that, right?
Okay.
It would not be very interesting for museum visitors to see that. It's just the information for us archaeologists that's that is
So would you have an idea of the date of that?
The date?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm coming to that. Don't worry, it will be very, very detailed. And so basically, but before discussing the date, just the first fragment was discovered in February.
Yeah.
And just a couple of months later, they reported to us a second fragment, and it had the same features. And this time it was located on the Japsand itself, as you can see here. It even needed to be excavated, so it was not in the tidal mudflats, but up on the sand, basically. And with the same features, and it was very good that they reported it to us, and that actually people just walk around in this area, just hiking. Without them, we would have never known that there was a wreck. So it's very important that there's a general awareness in the population that they know to whom they have to report such things, right? So one has to do also some public relations work as an archaeologist. I had the model of that, and lo and behold, it fitted together perfectly, like puzzle pieces, right? And although both wreck fragments were found at a distance of about 500 meters, it just fitted perfectly together. And also lined up the carvel bit and the lap strake bit. And so there can really be no doubt about it that this belonged together. And there could be some observations like the type of scars, which are different for the carvel planking and the lap strake planking. Here you have a vertical scar for the planking, and which is what you would expect in the lap strake construction. But you can really see two different technologies in one vessel, right? And then graving pieces on the left, it's basically where you had a fault in the structure of the wood, or even where you had to patch it, and details like that could be inferred. And then the great thing about modeling that is when you have that as a digital data set, you can also easily make cross sections. And they are really accurate. I mean, I cut that model digitally, basically, and basically sketched in the rest that was not accessible. And so you can make assertions where that would have been situated in the hull. And I would say this is just schematic. It's, I don't want to pretend this is a very good reconstruction, but just to give you a general idea, that would have been situated at the turn of the bilge. Due to that curvature, right? And you can see the floor timber and first fartuk. And from that we can make several inferences, and which are hypothetical but still very likely. based on that, where the turn of the bilge would have been, you can say that if you would have seen that float, you would think this is a carvel vessel, because only the carvel planking would have been above the waterline, and the lapstrake planking just would have been below the waterline. And you can infer just very general dimensions. It's just a guess, basically. And so I would say a small to mid-sized vessel engaged in the coastal trade. And then we come to the dendrochronological analysis, and we have a terminus past from of 1609 with basically sapwood or wain, even better. And the second fragment stated similarly. And we had also a sample without wain, so the date of 1617 already includes the margin of 20 years, which you would add when you don't have any sapwood. So the decisive date really is the one where you had the wain included. You know what wain is, or
Is it oak?
Yes. Okay. Hmm? If there are any questions, just let me know, right?
It's wait, oak? I thought wain was like the wainy face of the wood immediately under the bark.
No, that's
yes,
the
yes.
Species,
right.
Wood is like 25.
Yeah, yeah. And wain is basically the last
last ring.
Ring, basically.
Okay.
And so it's of course you have to add some years for for the
cutting
and the process of trading that timber or transporting it, and maybe even storing it for a certain time, and so sometime after 1609.
Yeah, how long they were seasoning oak in Northern
Europe? I have no clear idea about that. That's,
Peter cutting on with the guinea cup of material, he thought they were cutting it and seasoning at a maximum of a year.
Oh, right, yeah.
It's fairly green when they're using
it. Yeah, yeah, I've heard similar things, yeah. And so the provenance is the T value was not very especially high, but quite solid. And so either it's southern Scandinavia, Öland, Sweden, or northern Germany. And so to place it on a map, this is the find location. And these are the provenances. We have no clear provenance. It's not unambiguous. And and for the second fragment also in this about the same region, so generally one could say maybe southern Scandinavia, northern Germany. And interestingly, all parts of the hull came from one region. Often you have like planks from different region than framing, but here it's just from one forest basically. So that already indicates the rural character of the vessel, as you would imagine also, because you would also associate the lapstrake construction with a rural type of vessel at that time period, where carvel was already the standard in many, especially in urban shipbuilding, right? And if we compare that to other so-called half carvels, they are called half carvels in Sweden, which is a problematic term because it's more of a lapstrake construction, only in analogy a carvel, but it's nevertheless called half carvel, at least in Sweden. And here you have some other half carvel finds in Sweden, mostly in the north, in the Bottom Sea area, very in the vicinity of Stockholm, and the oldest actually in Sundsvall in 1577 in the Bottom Sea, but many other half carvels much later than that. And so we have one of the earliest so-called half carvels, and even one very early in the Netherlands. And this is quite interesting too, because this is also a very recent discovery. And the half carbon phenomenon has been often linked to Sweden specifically, but now the data kind of changes. And especially the half carbon was especially associated with the Roslagen skutans in Sweden, linked by a historical source basically. And but then we have also evidence from the western Swedish coast, from Kongsviken, built as late as 1938, not that long ago. And here you can clearly see the lapstake planking in the lower portion of the hull and the carvel planking in the upper planking. And you find that even in Norway, as you can see on the images, but quite different because you can see the lapstake portion above the waterline. And in some of the earlier Swedish, they would have appeared like proper carvel constructions. And they recently rebuilt one of them at a museum. And this is basically now the last so-called half carvel. They don't refer to that as half carvel construction. They just call it a siecte, not landsiecte. And then there's another group that is a variation on a theme where you have the upper part not in carvel but in alternating lapstrake fashion. And they are also clustered around, especially in Sweden, but also in Denmark. And we have also one fragment in Schleswig-Holstein. And the Swedish maritime archaeologist Niklas Eriksson pointed out that they too would have appeared like carvel construction, because the outer facing planks, they would have appeared like whales. And they are typical for carvel construction. So to the outside observer, that would have been a carvel ship too.
And so, I'm sorry, I interrupted.
No.
Well, I think I'm curious why that distinction. Why do they have the carvel planking above the turn of the bilge and the clinker, the lapstrake below it? And, you know, as you say, for someone on shore, they're going to see a carvel built boat. Is there a significance to that?
Yes, and I will come to that later.
To it. Okay. Yeah.
And there are several interpretations about that. The interesting bit about the so-called half carvels, or with mixed lapstrake and carvel or alternating construction, the North Sea wrecks, they are all built of oak and are seem to be of a local provenance. Whereas the constructions in Scandinavia, they are mostly built of pine. So there's a certain difference in that. And it seems that this cannot be seen as a phenomenon that is exclusive to the Baltic Sea or even the Scandinavian context, right? And then there's another variant, and this is basically a clinker built vessel or a lapstrake built vessel with a secondary planking of in carvel, basically with two layers. And that too would have been like a stealth construction. That too would have appeared like a carvel vessel. And they are centered especially around the southern part of the Baltic Sea, in Germany and Poland, and also one in Estonia, the Marcelin wreck. And also the northern Russians apparently had the seafaring of the Pomors that could be observed there too. Although I haven't found that many sources about that because I am not that fluent in Kyrillian. I wish I was.
Oh, my Russian is so poor.
My Russian is indeed so poor, I don't speak it at all. And but you have the same in this vessel, the Nordlandsjagd Anna Karolina, that is in the Nordlands Museum, which also has a secondary layer of carvel planking. So this is also spread across the same geographical area as the half carvel phenomenon. And how do we actually interpret this? This is so interesting. I mean, And the same with the Roslag and Scutans. They also received a secondary layer of carver because the lapsrake fashion was basically outdated. It was actually frowned upon, and so they received a secondary skin during a later repair. And the interesting thing is, if we put it on a timeline, all of these variants appear around the same time in the mid 16th century. And then there are some data gaps, which could be just due to the archaeological record, but who knows? I mean, sometimes when you see similar features, it doesn't mean that it's part of the same tradition. It could be just a reinvention or something like that. So it's not always obvious, right? And then we also know that the ships that I just presented, they would have been known by many different historical type names. So when you read historical sources, you would never know that they share this constructional method in common.
Mm-hmm.
And that just once again stresses the importance of also doing archaeological research in a basically historical context.
Mm-hmm.
Even when you think that you have many historical sources, they will never be enough to actually dig deeper into the matter on a constructional level. So for instance, half-carved constructions would have been known as Roslagen scooters or galleasses or even schooners, and you know this, you know this as well as I know that this is basically a type name based on the rigging of a ship, right? So this is the decisive factor. They didn't really care much how the hull was constructed when assigning a type name. So basically, now we come to the decisive question, what prompted this construction? A major point is that it was a tradition kept alive by practice, and one shipbuilder in Sweden who built a half carvel, he was asked, and he basically said, it's a bit tricky carver building. You see, you have to knock up the ribs first. Then you can't see what sort of a bottom she's going to get. And that's the most important part of a ship, after all. Now, when you build clinker, the ship takes shape under your hands. And if it don't turn out right, you can put it right, just like it should be. But once you've got over the bilge, the worst's over. Then you can put in the futtocks and raise the top timbers. They can only go one way. And then you can fill in the rest carver fashion. And you can use thicker planks too. When there's a rip, you can pull against to get a bend in the thick stuff. Well, you need it for the big ones. So this is what a maritime ethnographer recorded, and this really neatly shows the rationale behind that. Of
and
course, you can.
This quote in some of my papers on the Byzantine ships, actually.
Right.
They build a shell first up to the first whale, and then they need something to attach these whales to, depending on the place. So that's
perfect.
Yeah, it's right at the water line.
Mm. And this really explains this construction. So it's basically the traditional way of doing things. And basically the clinker or lapsrake fashion was still the traditional, a very intuitive way of ship construction. So it was the practitioner's point of view rather than the planner's point of view. And skeleton first is always associated with a level of planning. And it also shows the rural origin, and as you can see, where the location of the wrecks, these were rural origins, for instance, especially the Botnian Sea. This was basically the Swedish backwater, so to say. The next town, the next greater town was Stockholm, right? So But there are also other ideas that explain that, and there's also a socio-economic factor, because these early half carvels, where you can see only the carvel portion above the waterline, they would have appeared to outside of observers as proper carvel construction. They had a higher prestige, and this is something also that the Swedish maritime archaeologist Niklas Eriksson suggested. And in Sweden, carvels appeared around in the 16th century, around the same time, and they were like the ships of the king. And he had his ships of war built as carvel constructions because they were more suited to carry armament. And so the clinker vessels or the lapstrake vessels, they weren't really suited to carry armament, because you could not really cut gun holes into a clinker built hull, because that would weaken the structure. And so it would become top heavy if we have armament that would project over the gunwale, basically. And that's why it's called gunwale or gunwale, I guess. and then you have also an environmental response, because with regard to the secondary layer, the secondary carvel layer, with regard to the sand scooter, for instance, you were beaching on sandy shores, and then the hull would become leaky at one point. Or also possibly increased ice flows as a consequence of the Little Ice Age, and meteorological changes were noted in that time, probably because of the changes. People thought, oh, something is changing here, and so the first meteorological recording started in Stockholm and Riga to just observe the ice flows and when the ice would form. And so a secondary layer could have been also meant as like a bumper against the ice. But I don't know, this is just a hypothesis. And so this is a possible interpretation, right? And so conclusions, half carvel phenomenon, type or tradition, and I would say neither, because it's not a type, because there are different type names associated to that. Roslagen scooters, galleys, schooners, so it's not a type. And although it is broadly based in the shell-first clinker or lapstrake building tradition with regard to the lower portion of the hull, basically the essential part, half-carvel constructions are not necessarily an expression of just one homogeneous tradition. It's really difficult to trace, right? So rather, it's more a technical solution in response to outer influences for a variety of reasons, both are environmental and socio-economic. Thus, I would address it more as an analogous feature. But of course, this is just open to debate, right? There's no clear interpretation. There's only avenues of interpretation. So it remains an interesting subject, but let's go to another wreck that I also investigated. This was discovered at the southern spit of the island of Sylt. And here you can see already on the photo, it was discovered as a result of coastal erosion. And here you can see the location of that. And can you imagine why it was discovered in the middle of a dune, essentially? Here you have the map of the Prussian land register of 1877 projected on a digital elevation model. I think the digital elevation model is from 2014, I think 2 years before the wreck was discovered. Mm. What would you make out of that? Measuring error, or what would you say?
It's not a scale issue. It's not as if the 19th century map is too big, so you would, that isn't it.
No.
No, okay, that, I didn't think so.
Mm-hmm. It's probably, it's properly georeferenced. At first I thought it's an error in the data or in the measuring of the location, but everything was correct.
You said previously, are the dunes and the sand, is it migrating? Is it just shifting around and blowing with the good tides? Is that what happened?
Yes, kind of. You can see that historically you have a very strong coastal erosion process.
Yeah.
In 1877, this was quite a substantial part of the island, and 2014 it eroded already to a point that you had only very narrow southern spit of the island, basically. And just to put it in perspective, in 1793 the coastline would have been here, so around that time it would have made sense for a ship to run aground here, but not thereafter. So you can already in 1878 the coastline would be here, or the dune edge, basically. And you really had a coastal erosion, but also aggradation, mostly. And now it's switching back to erosion. And I really thought this is a measuring error. That can't be. I checked the data, and this map here is from 2014, and the wreck was discovered in 2016, just 2 years later, and yet it was not, it was outdated already, just a few months after the plan was drawn, right? And then I took this aerial photo from the same year, just a few months before the wreck was discovered. And then I traced the coastline of the aerial photos, which we can see here in purple. And just a few months before that, the dune edge has already advanced closely above the location of the wreck. And then a few months later, it retreated further. So that really shows you the force of nature, right? A very strong coastal erosion process. So the wreck was under beneath a dune for 300 years. And this side too was a tidal side, because you could not really access it. You really had to have low tide and offshore wind, basically. And then, so we also had to adapt the methodology, and we were really lucky to be in a position to take many photos, because on the photos you can draw a plan, you can trace a plan. You could not draw a plan within just 1 hour. That's what.
Yeah.
And so we had to rely on that. And so basically, here you see the wreck and the dune edge that has already moved about 50 meters further inland. And this was the view in October 2016. And then we were looking for another date to continue with the recording, but the either the tide was at a bad time of the day, or low tide at a bad time of the day, or we had onshore winds, or the general situation was just bad. So we didn't find a good day, and we received reports about the continued destruction of the wreck due to the tidal currents. So we thought we cannot wait any longer. We have to go there now and to try to record what we can see. And as you can see, it was still covered at low tide because of onshore winds. So we could not even take photos. At least you wouldn't see any, not much there, just a shadow basically. So I basically had to do manual recording, and here you have a colleague of mine, it's basically a very good GPS system. But still better. It's called SAPOS. It's a special satellite. It's a special system of the German Land Survey. So you can do real-time surveying with a measuring error, maybe up to maybe maximum 10 centimeters.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very, very precise, real-time surveying. And so basically this was a section in October,
yeah.
Basically walked around the wreck and took the points. And this was what he measured in December. And then I had this soaked hand-drawn sketch. You can see in the soap marks, and then
we've got many of those too.
And then it was just projected into that, and so you end up with
nice.
This plan, and you can really see how the sea worked itself about 10 meters into the wreck site.
Yeah.
But it lines up perfectly. It's no doubt it's part of one wreck. Here you have the midship section, here you have probably the stern section. Here we took several samples and have a terminus pascrum of 1690, and also two distinctive provenances for the planks, from the planks, basically the timber of the planks originated in what is now Poland, the Vistula region, and that this was a very typical place for getting timber or wood that was suited for making planks. And the framing came from the Havel River Valley or Brandenburg, which was floated down the Elbe River and was traded via Hamburg.
Mm.
And thus it was known as Hamburg timber, although it didn't came from Hamburg originally. But Hamburg timber was very well known for its sturdiness, and that this was often used for framing. So it totally makes sense. The interesting bit about this wreck is you have a very slender frame system, no build frames. The floor timbers and futtocks were not really built as one unit, but they were not interconnected, but only connected to joined to the outer planking, the shell, and at the same time you had very massive planks, and this is quite characteristic for Dutch style construction, and there are so many factors that just point into that direction. Another aspect that seems noteworthy is that the framing of the stern section is of oak, and the frames in the midship section is of pine. Now I preempt on the interpretation of a Dutch shipwreck. there are very nice historical sources, Dutch historical sources from that period. And just this phenomenon was described in a contemporary source by Niklas Witsen. Basically, he described the use of pine in merchant ships. He basically said, "Ships are also built of pine wood, but it is light and not as strong as oak, for which reason it is seldom used for ships of war or ships exposed to much violence. Yet for the upper and inner works, where not much force is exerted, it is very apt as for ships designed for loads, because pine wood is light, and ships made of pine wood float high on the water, and therefore can take more cargo." So we have already an indication that this is a merchant vessel. And then we took a very great sample, which was not only great for the dendrochronology, but you can basically read in the sample like in a book, because there are so many details in it. And this was really a fortunate coincidence, because we didn't have the equipment really to make a great recovery of timber remains. This was far away from any road network. It was just in the basically no man's land. And so, for instance, here you have the presence of spiker pennon. It's also a typical Dutch feature described in Niklas Witsen's book on shipbuilding. and it's basically related to Dutch shell-first cover construction. And a question to the audience, can you spot the decisive difference between carvel construction carried on in a shell-first manner as opposed to skeleton-first construction?
What do you mean the decisive? I'm not
sure I understand the question.
Yeah.
The decisive difference in terms of sequence, building sequence. On the left you find you have the shell first carvel,
yeah,
and on the right skeleton first.
They build up to the turn of the building on the left.
They
build up to the turn of the building on the left of the cleats.
Yeah, I would say the decisive differences, it's probably too obvious, that's why you didn't didn't.
The one
spot
on the left
it
is a dinosaur.
Right. I'm sure you're well of that, well aware of that. That the question was just too simple. The skeleton first carvel, you just erect the, you basically have the floor timbers and futtocks as one unit, erecting mainframes, and later add the planks. And in the Dutch style shell first carvel construction, you first add the planks,
yeah,
which is kind of difficult because, I mean, it's possible in clinker or lapstrack construction where they're overlapping, so you have a surface to add them to. And in the carvel building, you don't really have a surface, especially when you don't use like a tenon and mortise technique that you are well aware of in a Mediterranean context. So you basically added the planks with temporary devices like cleats, just nailed on that, just to hold them temporarily in place, and also great plank tongs, quite similar to clinker buildings where you had also tongs, and Thijs Malerveld, the late Thijs Malerveld, he actually inferred that how the spiker pennons came into place, and it's basically by removing the temporary clamps, cleats, and which you see on the left hand side, once you have inserted the floor timbers, you end up having many holes in the planks, which you need to plug. And as the cross section of iron nails were rectangular, you had to have rectangular wooden plaques, plugs. And these are the so-called spiker pennons. And they are barely discernible by the eye. You have to be really careful to spot them. Or you let the wood dry and then you can see them. and then there are also other features, for instance, what looks to me like fine charcoal on the right hand side, you see these kind of stripes, the black stripes. Fred Hogger pointed out this could be also brown rot, but to me, it looked more like charcoal, but I'm not sure.
Is that between the frames?
No, actually, I think beneath the frame.
Sometimes, yeah, you can get staining as well, if that's also sulfide-producing bacteria and things like that. But you can tell from the surface sometimes it's more rough.
Right. Yeah. So I'm not so sure about this feature, but it was difficult to, for me at least, to discern whether this is indeed charcoal. It looked to me like charcoal. And there's also a contemporary reference to that. When one burns the wood to bend it and it gives fine coal, this is a sign that it will bend well and is pliant. Coarse coal gives stiff and unbending wood. And as I mentioned, these planks, the thicknesses, they are unbelievably thick, like 6 or 7 centimeters. You can barely bend them. and in some portions of the hulls, you just needed to have that. And this could be, I think, this could be the garboard strake. And so this would be yet another indication for Dutch style, for Dutch style construction, because they had the habit of bending them over fire, and later to be replaced by steaming planks. Mm. Well, and then you have also another feature with some the tree nails, truncating tree nails, and this yet again can be, this can be associated with the double planking, when you had to, when you added a second layer, secondary layer of planking, and had to recut through the entire construction to insert the tree nails. Mm-hmm. And you can see that already here. There seems to be an indication for double planking. Here, the second and third, this seems to be doubled. Here, this seems to be doubled. Here, the ninth, number nine, seems to be two planks. So one could rule out that this is merely a repair that seems to be consistent in the preserved portion, right? And
so I have a question about that. Do they normally do that during construction, or do they sail the ship a few years and then do a whole refit?
The Dutch actually built that from the very start.
And
in some other cases, they later added a secondary layer when the hull became leaky. Mm-hmm. But the Dutch even had triple planking. Jeez. In some cases. There's yet another feature that would support this identification of a so-called double Dutch construction. There's even a name for a double Dutch construction. You see that there is a patch inserted here.
Yeah.
And on the other side of the plank, there's a knot.
Mm-hmm.
So they basically patched the knot over so that because to make it watertight, right?
Wow.
In the iron concretion, you had also some fibers of animal hair, which would not have been preserved if not for the iron concretion. And normally you find caulking material between the planks, but here it was on the outer side.
Was the hair kind of wrapped around the nail shaft?
Not really, it was just baked in. It was baked in. And so basically, it's you can see that caulking material or some what was applied to the outer surface, which is not a typical thing to do, right?
Mm-hmm.
Normally you just put it in between the planks.
Mm-hmm.
And there's also another reference to that, basically also a contemporary, Cornelis van Eyck, who said resinous matter and animal hair applied to the outer surface of the inner planking before the second planking is added. So it's basically like a sandwich, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so they were really concerned about making their vessels watertight.
Incredibly so. I mean, they, as you say, they put that wooden patch over the exterior face of the knot.
Right.
But yet they're still going to put another whole layer of planking on top of it.
Indeed.
As well.
Yes. And there's a good reason why they did that, because one reason might be that the carvel building method was still quite new in Northern Europe, and people might not have known how to properly caulk vessels.
Mm-hmm.
And another reason might have been that these ships were supposed to operate in waters that were quite far from home.
Mm-hmm.
And but I will come to that in a minute, and here you see even some scrapping marks, and basically here you have the mast step, and someone must have applied an axe to get some of the wood, and there's even there was even a law that shipwreck crews had only three high tides to make their vessels afloat again and to secure their belongings before the ship or wreck is cleared for scrapping. So you can imagine the panic in the eyes of the crew when the locals already appeared with their axes and just waiting. Maybe.
That's a good point. That's good.
No pressure at all.
Yeah. And don't mind us. We're
and,
fine.
And curiously, often none of the crews actually survived. Curiously.
What about like wrecking?
Yeah, it's, I mean, the local population had a natural interest that there were actually no survivors. Because if there were survivors, they could inform the owner of the vessel, and the owner could still claim a third of the retrieved cargo, right? So, very often there were no survivors at all, and there are some historical records that actually speak of piracy, and this is something that I hope to explore further. I'm working together with historians, and we are in the process of applying for a research project, and so we want to link the historical documentation to the wreck finds, and this will reveal quite a lot, I think, and will also help us to identify some of the wrecks, I hope.
Was the
question actually for this X that means that they're going to salvage that? It's marked for salvage.
You mean the X? No,
yeah.
No. I think this was
just,
from
just
in there from the start, basically as a drain,
okay.
So that the water. That collects in a mast step that could be could be drained.
And another question: did they do any deliberate wrecking on this coastline with, you know, fake beacon fires?
Oh, that's a good idea.
I
suppose so.
I think
there's evidence for that. I haven't delved so much into this issue because that's something for the historians to find out, but I read several chronicles, and there was certainly a episode in history where there was a lot of crime going on, and I wouldn't be astonished at all if they extinguished some some fires and just to lure some ships on. So I wouldn't be astonished at all. The funny thing about that is that the island of Sylt is now considered a very rich island with very well-to-do people who live there. Back in the day, it was there were a lot of criminals, and now probably also a lot of criminals, but just like tax avoidance schemes and stuff like that. But just other types of criminals, right? I'm joking.
I mean, I'm curious about the salvage too. Like when they were salvaging this stuff. Like, automatically, would a certain portion go to the king, for example? Could he claim it, or...?
Yes, 1/3 would go to those who are doing the salvage.
Okay.
Another 1/3 would go to the Duke of Schleswig.
Okay.
And the third would go to the owner, if an owner could still be found. And often the one in charge, there was a aristocrat in charge whom we call Deichgraf, and he often was a criminal himself. So he was the official was a criminal himself, so often the Duke would also not get his fair share. It would just be just the islanders would. and so I would imagine that many of those scrappings and salvage operations would not even find their way in the official documentation, right? And and so this is quite interesting, and if we put it in a global context, these are the wrecks that feature this kind of double Dutch construction, and you can see it's all scattered across the entire globe. And most of the wrecks with this construction, they were ships of the Dutch East India Company. And And actually, ships of the Dutch East India Company, for most of the time, they took a detour around Scotland because there were too many privateers in the English Channel. So they sailed around Scotland. So they actually crossed the North Sea. So it's not out of the way to actually have stranded on a German beach, basically. Mm-hmm. And we know of another Dutch East Indiaman, the Amsteland, that has stranded off the island of Sylt, but it doesn't match with the date. This can't be the Amsteland. And so
there's that report from the Christianshavn in Copenhagen, where they have all their Dutch ships, their Danish East Indiaman, they're built by Dutch.
Right,
ships.
Yeah. The BW2, which is marked in orange here.
Yeah.
That is a Dutch-built vessel, but built for the Danish East India Company. So that's why I marked it in yellow. It's a case in between, basically, but also built by the Dutch, right?
The builders are moving around.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah, they were quite active. And the most renowned example, of course, is the Batavia. Now, where you have a fragment of it exhibited in the Western Australian Museum. And according to a historical source, the Dutch East India Company started to build their ships with this kind of double planking or even triple planking since 1602. And but there are also other interpretations for double planking, because from a written reference, we know that around 1660, the Dutch reinforced their whalers also with a second layer of oak planking, which would have also made sense in the Arctic Sea with all the ice flows. So you have a reinforcement of the hull. And I would be surprised if there were any shipyards on Spitsbergen, who probably didn't have the infrastructure to mend the hull, so you really had to have very sturdy hulls to undertake this dangerous voyage, right? So
probably unrelated, but I mean, there are similar examples of double planking in the ancient Mediterranean. Like the Romans, when they built their really big, what we presume are the grain carriers, like they would have two layers of mortise and tenon planks on
right.
the inside.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
And for the East Indian, when you're going into waters with lots of tree worms.
And yeah.
Yeah,
exactly. That's the reason. Yeah.
Yeah.
And the Dutch East India Company even had three layers of planking, two oak layers, and a third of a coniferous species. And it was expected that the Tiridu navalis or other ship worms will just eat away at the third layer anyway, and so this was like a buffer, and it needed to be replaced before undertaking a voyage each and every time, right?
They had a mixture of like hair and powdered glass and pitch or something. Whoa.
Right.
Like that. Yeah, it was really nasty. But anyway, it's interesting you're talking about the double and triple planking of the Baltic, where that's not a problem.
Yeah.
Mm.
There's like other reasons to do it.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, you have many similar characteristics, but for different reasons, right?
Mm.
And the interpretations basically, vessels, maybe vessels of the Dutch East India Company. I actually found a written reference that there was, around the time of the Hörnum Odde wreck, a ship of the West India Company. I'm not aware of any written records that basically link them also to double Dutch vessels, but it would make sense. It would also make sense that they were built in a similar way, right? So then could have been a Dutch whaling ship. Or
where did the West India Company operate? In the Caribbean?
Sorry?
Where did it operate?
The West India Company? Yeah, the Caribbean. I mean, the Dutch still have a colony there, Curacao.
Yeah, right.
It's still part of the and they have some islands there as well. I think St. Martin or something like that.
No.
And some parts of that are part of the Netherlands proper of the state, and some others are just crown possessions. So they have this weird split up of two different kinds of oversea territories. And
remember the accounts of Columbus's voyages, he does three or four down there, and some of the ships get eaten very quickly.
Yeah.
And so even the Mediterranean sailors are kind of freaked out. the ships get eaten up.
Mm. And then, the double planking could be also linked to the specific conditions of the Wadden Sea, as mm-hmm. ships often fall dry at low tide.
Yeah.
So the hulls got worn down, and we know from the Danish so-called sand scooter, it's already in the name. The Danes had a vessel called sand scooter, which was basically always approaching coastlines at high tide, and then at low tide the vessels would fall dry, sit on the tidal mudflats, and they would be unloaded. Basically horse-drawn carts would come and unload them, and but the Danes built their as an ordinary construction, and later added during a later rebuild added the secondary layer of planking. So they did it in a different way to the Dutch. But I thought this was also maybe double Dutch constructions might be also linked to the Wadden Sea, but we don't know. I mean,
and the other thing with that is that if you're kind of the wood getting wet and dry and wet and dry, which is going to degrade it fast.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's a good point.
Exactly. That's a good
some
point.
Some of the Byzantine shipwrecks, the one I worked on for my dissertation, is all rot right under the first whale, which you think is about where the water line is.
Mm.
So that's a place where you had a lot of repairs.
Right,
a lot of pitch blobs just stuck on there.
Yeah, especially the part that always changed between that. I mean, there was relatively little problem that of the submerged part. As long as you had a protection against Tirero, and the parts that were above the way above the waterline, right, and the critical parts were at the waterline, and so these are the interpretations, and now we come to a reasonably new wreck, and this was also discovered at the Outer Barrier Islands. This portion of the wreck was reported to us just when COVID started in early 2020 from the Süderoogsand. It's the Süderoogsand 1 wreck, and this is how it looks. In the background you have this small island with only one house in which just one family lives. And that is the house of Holger Sprevli. He's basically the only inhabitant and with his family, and he's at the same time also the ranger of the National Park Wadden Sea. He has the responsibility for that region. So he's basically the only one who is regularly visiting the Süderoogsand. And so he was the only one to spot the wrecks, and he reported them. So we have this great cooperation going with him, and he also provided a lot of logistical support, because without him I would have never gotten there. There's no public transport. it's really an adventurous trip, really. And it basically started in, I think this was March, and we got the at that time we were not allowed to do any field work due to the COVID pandemic. So I sent Holger very detailed instructions what to do. So basically he and his colleague, they were carrying out a survey on on our behalf voluntarily, and they took so many photos that I could create this great structure for motion model.
Mm-hmm.
And they even took samples for us, and and I made a very, very detailed description how to that you basically have to note from where you have extracted them, and so that it could be reconstructed. And they did such a great job. It's incredible.
Yeah.
I mean, they're and that really just shows that it's important also to include more people from the general public also into archaeological operations, especially in remote parts, which could not be reached by archaeologists at all times, right? And this was the start of a very wonderful cooperation. And a few months later, I had the chance to visit that wreck myself.
Oh, that's cold.
Not really. Not really. And this was in April, and here you see another feature in the construction of the wreck. Can you point to that? Question to the audience. You can see here the ceiling planks, the framing, and you can see the outer planking. Is there anything peculiar about the outer planking?
About the outer planks?
Yeah.
It looks like it's double planked.
Exactly. So, what are the chances to find two double planked ships in a row? So we have now 1/5 of our double Dutch construction, and it is a double Dutch construction too, I checked it. So this is really weird, really weird. And the double Dutch construction was initially, it was thought this is just a fleeting phenomenon of the early, of the late 16th century, early 17th century.
Uh-huh.
But now we have wrecks in this dates into the around 1733, and both the Hörnum Odde wreck and this wreck, they are the latest examples of this building tradition, and this is really interesting because it opens a new research question, and we are working together with our Dutch colleagues with Martin Manders. Who's two of his PhD students, they have a similar question with regard to actually the oldest of the double Dutch constructions. So we are trying to work together on this issue, on this central question, and this is really interesting. And another interesting subject is wreck site formation. And also the change of the tidal landscape. And just 1 year later, this tidal creek silted up, or the tidal creek actually moved further to the east. So this landscape is in a constant change, and subject to a constant change. And so either the wrecks get broken up basically in the surf zone, or torn apart by tidal currents, or they are covered again. So either one of both, or both at the same time, or they are torn apart and then they get covered up. It's so interesting. And and basically, and another interesting thing is when you make accidental finds, which is not very often because due to the tidal currents, finds usually get washed away. But this was sticking out from the sediment, and Holger actually discovered that. That's Holger, the only inhabitant of that island. He refers to himself as the king of Süderoog.
Why not?
Yeah. and And this is also quite interesting because that's a Dutch faience, which once again supports the interpretation as a double Dutch construction. It really fits well together, right?
You're confident of the association.
Yeah, I'm pretty confident about that. Although I've, as just shown, there are so many other shipwrecks that also feature a double construction, right? But I'm pretty confident that this is also double Dutch construction, but because I also spotted some spiker pennants in this one, which I could really not discern with my eyes, but I had a sample or a piece from a sample that I just let dry. And then you can see that more clearly, the tree nails and the spiker pennants. So then I was certain about that. And it's also such a great symbol for early globalization, because you know what Dutch faiences are about. Do you have any idea?
They were
porcelain imitation.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Man, you're so knowledgeable.
Yeah.
It's incredible. I mean, yeah, it's back in the day, made in China was actually something good.
Yeah.
Something worth emulating. Now it's the other way around, right? And so they emulated that because that was like the table were considered as really for the wealthy and the aristocracy, and you find that not only in the tableware but also in tiles. You have a whole culture of that, and it's basically and this you find those tiled living rooms. This is very characteristic for both the Netherlands but also Schleswig-Holstein. And Schleswig-Holstein was heavily Dutch influenced because the western, they were basically related. The western coast of Schleswig-Holstein, they were colonized by the Frisians, and the Frisians still formed a bond to the Frisians in the Netherlands. So we speak of the western Frisians and the north Frisians. And they never formed a political entity, but they were culturally very close. And you can also see that in the hiring practice, because many mariners were hired from the Frisian Islands by the Dutch. And the Dutch refer to the Frisian Islands as the Little East, I think. At that time, the Frisian Islands, they formed part of the Kingdom of Denmark. They exported tiles, it's called a Delft blue. Mm. And they really exported Delft blue on a grand scale to not only the islands, but also the coastal cities. And it not only had a decorative character, but also you can see the biographies of those who live there, the seafaring population. You really have a maritime culture there, but also ship biographies. And on the top right corner, you have two ships that were commanded by a captain from Hoge, from the island of Hoge, called Tade Hans Bandix. And one of the ships he lost off the coast of Sweden. But he was entrusted with another command, so it was apparently not his fault that he lost the ship. And he was on the trading route of trading timber from what is now Finland, Frederikshavn, which is now called Hamina in Finland, across the Baltic Sea to Amsterdam. And so you have this Hoge, a captain in the service of a Dutch shipping company. And I was so surprised to find the tile image on the which you see on the left side, with a Russian flag. And I was really perplexed to see that, but then I did some research about that. And it was a ship, a three-masted galliot, that was registered in the port of Riga, which is now the capital of Latvia, but back then it was part of the Russian Empire. So it flies the Russian flag. But it was owned by a Dutch shipping company. It operated on the very same timber trading route, commanded by another captain from Hoge. So they it was basically the island of captains, I guess. and so you can see something that we typically associate with our age. I mean, for our time, it is typical to have a cargo ship under the flag of some kind of banana republic in Middle America, where they don't have any regulations, so it's easier for them. They don't have to. It's also tax wise easier for them.
All the yachts from Delaware here.
Yeah.
So there's got to be a legal reason.
Yeah, exactly. It was just cheaper for them,
yeah.
and they had a crew mostly of nowadays with from the Philippines.
Yes.
It's quite common, and the officers are yet from another country, and it's not that new of a phenomenon really. And I found this quite striking, and. Yeah, it's still preserved in the home decor, not in the wrecks themselves, but also on land. You find that in the maritime culture, and find that fascinating. And now we come to basically the last wrecks that I visited a few days ago. And here have the wreck of the Ulpiano, a Spanish bark that stranded here at in the Christmas night of 1870. There's a very nice local story connected to that, because the crew, all of the crew survived, and they were rescued. You can see this beacon over here. This is a relatively new beacon, and all beacons have a safe room. So the crew could actually disembark and could find shelter in the beacon, and 2 days later they were saved. They were saved by the predecessor of Holger. The beacon, how it looked in his age, and he basically saved the crew.
Mm.
And here you can see he was actually responsible for retrieving and salvaging the cargo from shipwrecked vessels. And here you can see his Austrian card at low tide, and the boy sitting on the wreck of the old piano. And all the crew could be saved. And there's actually a nice story. The crew was kept there because there was just no possibility to reach the mainland. Because there were many storms, it was in December, and so his son learned the Spanish guitar during that time. So there's a very nice story with connected with that, and so it's you can see that archaeology is also not only important for us archaeologists from a merely scientific point of view, but it's also important for the local history, for the sense of the place, for the local population, because it's just part of their history. And here you can see a new wreck that was just basically Il Piano in the background, and here a new wreck that was just unearthed as a consequence of a great storm. The tips, previously only the tips of the frames could be seen years before, but really some thousand cubic meters of sand must have washed away as a consequence of the storm. It's just incredible. And I had not much time to really investigate it in much depth because it's just a few days ago. But some details I observed, for instance, was, well, for instance, there's this dead eye and with the chain plane still attached, which would have corresponded to that part. And then the stem post, this concretion looks a bit as if it could have been part of the bobstay, but I don't know. And the rabbit for the hood ends of the planks, they entered the into the stem post at a very flat angle. So you would associate that to a vessel with a very rounded hull, right? And that was quite typical for very rounded and flat bottomed hull. And these would have been the kind of vessels that you would expect to have that kind of hull, like a galliot or a smack and or a kuf. And they had one advantage in this, they were very adapted to that kind of environment because they had a very shallow draft and they could use the tidal window much better. And if they were if they sailed across the Wadden Sea, that would turn into tidal mudflats at low tide. They wouldn't tilt over, like when you have vessels with a deep keel or something, they wouldn't just tilt over. It would be pretty safe, right? And just to illustrate that, here you have a kind of flat bottom vessel, although this is different than the one I showed, but it just gives you an idea of what it would have been like to fall dry at low tide and just to unload and just to wait for the tide to. So yeah, basically this was my presentation.
All right.
I hope it was interesting.
Thank you very much, Daniel. Extensive and thorough and cold. I still don't know how you do that. I am impressed.